Don Lemon, you're here in Washington. I got to ask you, the president had that disgusting tweet the other day attacking you, LeBron James. Just walk us through how you reacted when you saw that and what has happened since.
I didn't really, I don't follow the president anymore on Twitter because it's too much, and I find his tweets to be outrageous, and I find them to be most of the time beneath the dignity of the office. I think that it's tough to sit here on television now and criticize the president. I think that we have more respect for the office than he does. So I didn't really know that he tweeted about me until my phone, until people started saying, are you okay? Oh my gosh, I can't believe he's doing that. And my response was, what are you talking about? And then they sent me a copy of what the president said about me. And so I just thought about it for a little while, and I woke up the next morning and tweeted out what I said. Who's the real dummy? Is it someone who puts kids in classrooms, as LeBron James is doing, or is it someone who puts kids in cages and separate their families at the border? And I stand by that. So I think it's awful. I think it's disgusting. As I said here on CNN before, I think this president traffics in racism. I do believe that this president is a racist, and I don't say that lightly. I think the evidence points to it, and I did that on my program last night. I showed some of the evidence, not even all of the evidence, what he says about people of color, what he says about women. He's also a misogynist. What he says about women and what he says about other people. He does, he's an equal opportunity offender, but he also tramples over racial norms and sensitivities. And I think what he is playing on with this, with me and with LeBron James, is an old racist trope about black and African Americans or people of color being of inferior intelligence.
It started with Congresswoman Maxine Waters, the
low IQ individual.
Before you, yeah. Before LeBron, he was going after her. She was critical, very critical of him. He was going after her, saying she's low IQ, Maxine Waters, and he would ridicule her, saying her IQ was one in the 60s.
Yeah, well, Maxine Waters has been in political life a lot longer than this president and will probably still be around when this president is out of office. So I think to call Maxine Waters a low IQ individual, again, I think it's beneath the dignity of the office. We have to remember the president's supposed to be a statesman. And statesmen don't speak that way, they don't write that way, they don't conduct themselves that way. So I think it would be, it is incumbent upon the president to learn from his past mistakes and to try to correct them and to become a better person, a better statesman, a better leader of all people, not just the people who voted for him. And I think it's incumbent upon the people in his own party to hold him to account, because it's not really up to me to hold him to account. I am not a lawmaker. I'm neither a Democrat nor a Republican. I'm not political. I simply give the facts. I did an interview with LeBron James. LeBron James shared his story. So I think it's incumbent upon the people, especially the people in Washington, to hold him to account.
Can I just add, it is up to us, I think, to hold, not I think, I know, to hold our elected officials to account,
yes,
on the facts, as you mentioned.
On the air.
No,
yes,
I know.
I'm talking about here in Washington politically.
I totally agree. And I think the way that we can hold them to account in this particular discussion is LeBron James did something and is doing something pretty remarkable,
right,
that we would want all of the athletes that our children look up to do, which is, mm-hmm, to give back to their community in a pretty amazing way, use, mm-hmm, their big fat salaries to do that. And what Don Lemon did is bring that to the country and to the world in the interview. And yeah, LeBron James made a statement, not even using the president's name or, specifically talking about the way that he's acting, but obviously about what the president has done with the NFL. And that's his prerogative. Mm-hmm. And that's called discourse. And when you have anybody to respond to that with an ad hominem attack, much less the president of the United States, it is important to call it out.
Yeah. Go ahead, Sabrina.
I think that whenever the president makes incendiary comments, we often spend a lot of time talking about the politics, but it's also important to note that Donald Trump's views on race predate his political career. Now, first of all, he launched his political career by questioning whether or not President Obama, the first black president in the history of his country, was actually born in the United States. But you think back to his time in New York in the early 70s, of course, Trump and his father, their company was sued in a racial discrimination lawsuit for discriminating against African-American tenants at their rental properties. He took out the full page ad calling for the death penalty for 5 black and Latino men in the Central Park 5 case, which, of course, those men were exonerated, and yet Trump continued to push the notion that they were somehow guilty. And even on the campaign trail, he tried to incite violence against Black Lives Matter protesters. and also suggested that inner cities were war zones. So we've seen enough evidence, I think, to support the notion that this is not just politics. Perhaps this is what the president really thinks and really believes.
Yeah, and you know, I think, you know, Don used a very important word. He talked about racial norms and how the president's trampling on racial norms. You know, for a long time in this country, we've known that there are people who harbor these kinds of views. Mm-hmm. And I think what's really interesting is that prior to the president coming to office, you know, our experience was that, generally speaking, people kept those views to themselves. And what I think I want people to know is that as people of color kind of walk around and kind of live their life, we are having a different experience as a result of the president setting a very different tone with regard to this sort of rhetoric. So I think it's just important for people to know that this new tone, this new norm is having an impact on people that is unfair to a large portion of this country.
You know, when I saw what the president said about you, I remembered some of the interviews you've actually done with Donald Trump. He's been on your show when he was a candidate earlier, and I always thought that there was a mutually respectful relationship that you had with Donald Trump.
Yeah, let me go back before that, and I will answer your question. The last time I interviewed Donald Trump before he ran for office was the night that Osama bin Laden was killed. And it was before he was killed, and we had a row about the birther issue. And it didn't get much pickup because we know what happened with Osama bin Laden. But he had vowed that he would never come back on do an interview with me because he said I was racist, because I challenged him on an infactual statement that he made,
like
a lie.
You're
about
racist?
I was racist because of the way that I challenged him, much in the way that he thought maybe, you know, that I can't somehow be unbiased about an issue concerning race like Judge Curiel, because I'm African American. So he accused me of being racist. So finally, he decided he would do an interview with me, and my producers intervened, and we talked and whatever. I did an interview, and he said, oh my gosh, you're really good. I really respect you.
I remember that.
You're a great interview. It's really fair. And then he kept doing interviews with me after, subsequently after that, 8 or 9 of them. And then once he became president of the United States and you have to hold his feet to the fire, all of a sudden he doesn't like what I'm doing because I have to call out the lies or the misstatements, or when he gets something wrong and when he does something crazy or when he says something, when he tweets something that's just beyond the pale, all of a sudden he doesn't like me. During the campaign, I was told that the only people that the campaign wanted to come on my show were the paid CNN contributors, because they were afraid that the other people who were possibly going to be in the administration or work for Donald Trump would be embarrassed because I challenged them in interviews. Well, if you don't want to be challenged in interviews, then you need not be running for a political office or to work for someone who's going to be the president of the United States. So that's the long and short of it. So I think that he started out by calling me a racist, and then what it ends up is that, again, as the conversation I've been having on the air with Chris Cuomo and others, is that it is complete projection. If you look at this president, whatever he says, he is projecting. It's what he believes about himself.
I was happy, though, that Melania Trump came out with a statement in support of what LeBron James is doing in Akron, Ohio.
I think that's great that Melania Trump did that. I give her credit for it. I don't know if we should read too much into it, because we also have to remember she was a birther, too.